Hi friends, welcome to EduTab. So welcome to part 3 of Agricultural Engineering. So friends, as part of this chapter, we have already covered 3 lectures already. One is on tractors specifically, wherein we have dealt with the types of tractors and the important data points that you need to keep in mind for the examination, right? Then there was part 1, Agricultural Engineering, wherein we started from the basics of like what is actually Agricultural Engineering. We also dealt with some of the important terminologies that you need to know, like, you know, the horsepower, brake horsepower, frictional horsepower, right, indicated horsepower. So all these things we understood what it is, and then we saw the various sources of farm power as well. We moved on to understand what is farm mechanization and how at the various day-to-day operations in agriculture we make use of the tools and implements. So we saw that it can be categorized into various stages, like, you know, from land, the leveling process that is done, to sowing of the seed, seed bed preparation is there. Then you have interculture operations, you have harvesting, you have fertilizer applications and etc. Right? So each of these we saw them in detail. For example, land leveling, we saw how scoops and scrapers are used. For seed bed preparation, how important is our tillage operations, and we saw that tillage implements we need to deal with separately. Now in this lecture, we are going to connect with that part wherein we are going to discuss all the tillage implements separately as part of this video, right? And then we also moved on to see the various implements used at the stages of, for example, the harvesting stages, right? And then the sowing, for sowing also we use seed drill, seed cum fertilizer drill. So these were some of the things, just a quick revision I was trying to give so that you can relate to what we have already studied. Right? So let us quickly begin with today's lecture, that is part 3. So friends, we have still now, we are actually dealing with this topic, or we have been dealing with this topic previously, even in basics of agriculture, wherein under agronomy, we saw how important is tillage operations, okay? So basically, you can say that without this, you cannot start or you cannot think of the other operations that subsequently follow. So now I would really want you to go back to those lessons, have a look at what is tillage, what are the classifications of tillage. So unless and until you know that, coming to this particular part is not going to be helpful, okay? So better first complete those parts, understand what are tillage operations, what are the various classifications, and then come back to this particular lecture wherein we shall see important tillage implements, right? So just a quick recap here, that the classification of tillage system based on time, okay, like with respect to the crop, can be under preparatory tillage and after cultivation. Okay, so when I say preparatory tillage, I haven't started sowing the crops yet. Okay, so I'm preparing the seed bed for them. Okay, and after cultivation means once the crops have been cultivated, I'm doing certain tillage operations in the standing crop. Okay, so this is a two classification. Now, if you talk about preparatory tillage, again, you can classify it into primary tillage, you have secondary, and you have layout of seed bed. Okay. So now in this lecture, we will see what are the primary tillage implements and what are the secondary tillage implements. So that is what is going to be the scope of this particular lecture today. So friends, let us start with the primary tillage implements first. So as we know that when you go back, have a revision that what is primary tillage. So basically what you're doing is the first step, the first time you're plowing the land, it comes under the primary tillage operations. Okay. See, what happens is you need to understand that you cannot immediately start sowing the crops in a field. Okay. Because of the various conditions, like because of repeated sowing on a particular land, or because of the fluctuating climatic conditions, like maybe one time rainfall, all the other time sunlight. So what happens is the soil becomes quite compact, okay, and it becomes difficult for you to start sowing immediately. So before sowing, you need to prepare the seed bed for the crops to actually start cultivating, okay? So for that, the first thing you're doing is plowing. Okay, now what does plowing do? Basically, it separates the top layer of soil into furrow slices, okay? So when I say furrow, I mean a depression in the land. Okay, you can have a look at it in the picture, right? So this is what actually plowing does. So now when you start doing this operation, you will see that the soil starts to become loose, friable, okay? And then it becomes easier for us to sow the seeds. Now, other thing you need to understand is that when you are plowing a land, there can be partial or complete soil inversion, okay? So when I say soil inversion, the bottom layer is brought to the top and the top layer is actually taken sideways. Okay, it is turned sideways basically. Okay, so this inversion, wherein the lower layers are brought to the top through plowing, it can be partial or it can be complete. Okay, so this is some important points that you need to keep in mind. Now moving on, before we see the various implements that are used for this kind of operations, let us have a look at certain terms which is important. Okay, now if you see here, it is furrow. Okay, it is a trench. Trench means a depression on the land. Okay, it is formed by an implement in the soil during the field operation. Fair enough, right? We have just now seen that picture. Okay, now what is furrow slice? Now if you start creating a depression in the field, what happens is there is a mass of soil which is actually cut in that particular position, right? So that particular mass of soil is referred to as furrow slice. Okay, then you have furrow wall. Okay, you have crown, the top portion of the turned furrow slice. So you can see here you have depressions created, and the area which is the soil which is occupied in this area is turned away sideways. Okay, like this. So this is what they're referring to, the top portion of the turned furrow slice. Okay, and the top portion is known as crown. Okay, so similarly you have back furrow, you have dead furrow. Just have a look at these terms, have a cursory look at, on it. Do not go deep into it, because these are some definitions which they will not ask directly, but at least to understand the concept you need to have an idea, right? Okay, now coming to the different types of plows that are there. So first one is the indigenous plow, which is also known as a country plow, basic one. Then you have the mold board plow, you have disc plow, you have chisel plow, you have subsoiler and rotary plow, right? Okay, so first starting off with the very basic thing, okay, that is the indigenous plow. Let us have a look at a picture and then the parts of it. So here in the picture, you can see there is a body here. Okay, then you have share. Okay, this is the pointed end, and this particular part is actually used for penetration. Okay, so if you can see that there are two important parts. One is the share and the other is the shoe. Okay, this shoe basically is the supporting part. Okay, with the help of this shoe, this share is actually stabilized and it penetrates into the ground. Okay, so the other parts being beam, you can see here. Okay, there is handle, obviously, because it is manually operated, you require a handle in indigenous or the country plow. Okay, so now let us have a look at some of the important points. So now this indigenous plow can either be animal drawn or it can also be manually operated sometimes. Okay, now you need to understand that we have seen that it has a part which is called share. Okay, that penetrates into the ground, so it creates a V-shaped cut, or it is called V-shaped furrows. Okay, and the depth of that furrow is basically 12 to 15 centimeter, important for us. And the other point that you need to note is the field capacity. It is around 0.4 hectares per day of 8 hours. Now why is this 8 hours? Because we are taking into account the maximum time a human being can actually invest on the agricultural field. So that is why we are accounting nearly 8 hours of manual work. That is why we say that 0.4 hectares per day of 8 hours. So kindly make note of these important points. Next, moving on to mold board plow, okay, MB plow as it is called. So again, have a look at the components of it. You can see that there is share, again the pointed part that penetrates into the ground. We had also seen this particular part in the previously seen implement, which was indigenous plow, right? Then you have this mold board. Okay, you can see here, we will have a look at it in detail as well. Then there is a piece called frog, there is a landside. Okay, so these are some of the basic parts of your MB plow. Then if you see the parts that we were dealing with, so again always remember that always there's going to be a penetrating portion in the implement that is going to actually cut open the field. So this is a share part, and again this is going to be common for most of the things that we see. Then you have a mold board. Okay, it is a curved part. Okay, so we have just now seen that in the picture, it formed a curved pan like part. Okay, and this particular part is actually used to lift, turn and pulverize the soil slice. Okay, so basically first penetration performed by share, then the overturning of the soil, which is done by the mold board. Okay, so these are the two important parts, so kindly make note of these. So now you can have a look at the functions of MB plow, which are again very important for us to remember, right? So first cutting the furrow slice, lifting the furrow slice, inverting it, and then pulverizing it. Okay, so when I say pulverizing, it means to break down into finer particles, right? So this is important. Now again a quick revision. So we were using share. Okay, share is used for penetration. You have a mold board, okay, which is used for lifting and inverting the slice. Okay, so you can relate to it like which of the following parts performs the following functions, right? So keep these important points in mind. So friends, now have a look at the picture here. Okay, so on the left hand side you have a two bottom MB plow, okay, and on your right hand side the same two bottom MB plow is tractor mounted, right? So you can have a look at it here and remember the term PTO. You need to relate it then and there. Okay, so we had seen that power takeoff shaft. Through this, what happens is the power from the tractor engine is taken up by the implements which is attached to them, right? So that is what you need to always keep relating so that you keep the concepts in mind. Now here you can see this is one part and this is the second part, so it is called two bottom. This can also be two, three or even four bottom, okay? So you need to understand that. Now friends, these are some of the important specifications. Okay, there's nothing which I can explain you in this particular tabular column, okay, but I have included this to just make you understand that it is important. Okay, you need to keep these values in mind. At least you need to know the capacity and the power requirement. These two data points are very, very important. Please, I'm repeating it because there are direct questions that are picked up from these particular areas. Okay, so that is why you need to stop the video here and make sure you memorize them. Same thing again here, it is again the important specifications. This is specifically for two bottom MB plow. Okay, in the previous tabular column it was for 2 to 4. Okay, so here you can see specifically pinpointing upon this particular part, two bottom, right? Again, coming to the next kind of implement, that is primary tillage implement, we have just now seen about the various kinds of plows. The first one was the indigenous plow that we had discussed, right? And the second one was MB plow. The third one is disc plow. Okay, so as the name itself suggests, you will have disc-like structures which are used to break open the soil, right? And basically, one important point that you need to note is that MB plow, wherever you're not able to use it, okay, like for example, if the terrain is very hard or the soil is very dry, then you would go on to disc plow because the shape of it is such that it makes easier to make a cut on the soil, okay? So that is why this particular implement becomes important. Again, if you see here also, it can be 2, 3 or 4 bottoms. Okay, so when I say 2, 3 or 4 bottoms, you can say that there can be 2, 3 or 4 discs which are involved in cutting open the soil, right? So here you can have a look at this picture. So here you can count these discs here. So you have 1, 2, 3 and 4. So totally you call this as 4 bottom disc plow. Okay, so as we have seen earlier, in the case of MB plow also it can be 2, 3, 4 bottom. Now under disc plow also there are various types. One is the standard disc plow and the other is the vertical one. These are some of the technical things that we actually do not need to understand for examination, but you need to know that yes, there exist two varieties of it. Okay, now here you can have a look at the picture of the disc plow. You have the various parts. So again you have the disc which are actually used for penetration, right? And then this is a central beam on which these discs are attached. Okay, and other thing you can see here is here there's a link attachment point. Okay, so basically whenever you want to attach it to a tractor, this particular part is used. So now having a look at the important parts of the standard disc plow. So here you can have a look at the two important data points. One is regarding the disc angle, right? And the other is regarding the tilt angle. Okay, so when I say disc angle, I am referring to the angle which actually the disc makes with the direction of travel. Okay, so suppose this is the disc and it is penetrating into the ground. So we take into account the angle at which it does so. Okay, so the recommended angle is between 42 to 45. 45 degree. This is important. Just make a note of it. And this is basically for standard disc plow. Okay. When you talk about vertical disc plow, the angle usually varies from 40 degrees to 45 degrees. So kindly make note of these important points, right? And then talking about the tilt angle. Okay. So it is nothing but the angle which the disc actually makes with a vertical line. Okay. Which is an imaginary line rather. So again, this tilt angle is going to be from 15 to 25 degree, which is a standard. So these kind of questions are usually asked in the examination, right? Okay, so coming to the vertical disc plow. Okay, so basically one important point that you need to understand is this particular kind of plow basically combines the principle of the regular disc plow plus disc harrow. Okay, now what is this disc harrow? So when we will be studying about the secondary tillage implements, we will come across this particular equipment, which is disc harrow. So this vertical disc plow basically is a combined model of these two things. Okay, and it is used for shallow working in the soil. This is important. So usually it does not go deep into the soil, but remains or it is used for very shallow operations. So make note of it. It is also called as harrow plow or one-way disc plow. Okay, because why harrow plow? Because it combines the feature of disc harrow as well, right? We have already talked about the disc angle 40 to 45 degree. Then moving to specifications. So again, as I told you that there's nothing much for me to explain out here, but this particular tabular column is important, and that is why I've included this in the video also. So the number of furrows, basically it is 2 to 4. Okay, and you need to understand that working depth is also going to be important for us. So up to 300 mm. Okay, so basically this is a probable question that is usually asked. Fine, so we have been dealing with the indigenous plow, we have dealt with the MB plow, we have seen what is disc plow, the types of it, standard, vertical, right? And now we have other types of plows that are also used in the field. One is a chisel plow. Okay, you have subsoilers and rotary plow. Let us see some of the important features of each. So basically, chisel plow, you can have a look at the picture here. Okay, so you can automatically, when you look here, you can see that there are a lot of tines. Okay, the blades. See this one, which I'm marking in red color. So these are basically the blades which enter or penetrate into the ground. Okay, so now what is going to be the function? Obviously, breaking the hard layers of soil. See friends, one important thing that you always need to keep in mind is whenever I'm talking about plow, the important function that it is performing is to break the soil. Okay, break the hard layers of it. So that is going to be the same for any of the plows that we use. But yes, each of them will have specific functions. Okay, for example, when we were dealing with MB plow and disc plow, we also saw that the places which have hard soil, okay, or dry soil, we usually prefer disc plow. Why is it so? Because of the shape that it has. So it easily penetrates into the soil because of the disc shaped structures. Okay, so here again you can see that tines are there in chisel plow. Okay, and this is also a kind of an implement which is used where in the places where it is very hard. Okay, hard terrain. So this is important. Just keep this point in mind. Then you talk about subsoiler. Okay, you can have a look at it. Okay, now plow depth becomes important. Okay, so you can have a look at the long penetrating structures that it has. Okay, and basically the depth may be 40 centimeter or more, or maximum up to 100 centimeter. Now the depth is going to be more obviously because you can see that the penetrating structures are quite long and sharp out here. Okay. And one important point is that this particular plow is designed such that it goes into a greater depth when you compare it with the conventional plows. Okay. Now the next implement is a rotary plow. So you can see here how there is a horizontal bar, okay, on which you have the discs mounted. There's a rotational action that takes place when these discs move over the field. Okay, that is why you say rotary plow basically. Now these rotary plows are used to cut and pulverize the soil. So when I say pulverize, it means breaking it into smaller particles. Okay, and this is used for shallow cultivation and weed control. So friends, we are done with the discussion of the primary tillage implements. Now we are going ahead with the discussion of the secondary tillage implements, right? So friends, what we are doing as part of primary tillage is that we are breaking open the soil, okay, and we are trying to make the soil loose or friable, okay, and after that we are moving towards secondary tillage operations, wherein we are going to break the clods. Now what are these clods? Clods are basically clumps. So initially when you start plowing the soil, after that there are various clumps of soils that are left behind, and even there are a lot of weeds which are there, okay. Now to remove these things, we do these secondary tillage operations, okay. So basically the idea, you need to understand that why are the secondary tillage implements used? To actually break the clods that are there after plowing. So that is exactly what one of the most basic equipment that is used for this harrow is used for, okay. So now let us move ahead, see the various types of it as well. So now let us see the types of harrows which are used in India. So basically you can see there's disc harrow, there's spring tooth, there's spike tooth, there's blade harrow, okay, and there's triangular, there's bodela, there's zigzag, bindha. So all these are very well explained in the content sheets, okay, but I've put this section here just to make you aware that there are various types and you need to know the names as well. Now the basic idea is the same for what it is used for secondary tillage operations and what are those to break the clods which are formed after plowing, right? And now one category of it is the blade harrows, okay, and it is important for you to keep these names in mind. That's Bakhar, Guntaka and Budela, right? So now let us talk about Bakhar in particular, okay. So as we have just now seen that it is an example of blade harrow, right? So what happens is, friends, here there's a concept that you need to get it right, that when you are using the tillage implements, there are two kinds of things that you're performing, okay. The first thing what happens is you're making a cut in the soil, okay. Now the purpose of doing this is to basically make the soil friable, okay, that is loose. So that is the first function that is usually performed, and when you see plows are usually used for this purpose, okay. The second thing that you're doing is soil inversion, okay. So when I say soil inversion, what you're trying to do is that bottom layers are brought to the top, okay. There's a proper mixing of the soil that is taking place, okay. So here if you see this particular instrument or implement rather, sorry, so the Bakhar is basically containing one or more blades, okay, and it is used for shallow working of the soil with minimum soil inversion, okay. So usually what happens is when you use the secondary implements, the soil inversion functions usually performed, okay, but in the case of Bakhar, it is used for minimum soil inversion. This is one important point. Plus this particular implement is used to prepare seed beds mostly in clay soils, okay. So this is important point, so kindly make note of this as well, okay. And other blade harrows are actually, here you can see Guntaka, okay, it's an improved type of blade harrow. So even you can get a question like, you know, which of the following is a kind of a blade harrow, so you need to be aware of the various names as well, right? Then there is Bodela. This is again a twin blade harrow which is used in the southern region of India, okay. So this is important, kindly make note of it. Then you have disc harrows. So we have been seeing harrows in general, then the blade harrows under it, now disc harrows. So obviously from the name itself you can see, when I say disc harrow, the penetrating part is going to be in the form of a disc, okay. So the same thing we were also having a look when we were studying about plows, there was something called disc plow, right? So again that was having a disc shaped structure. So again this is the same case with harrows as well. So it has a set of rotating disc, as we have just seen. There's a common shaft on these discs are actually placed, okay. And disc harrow again are used for hard ground, and the same was the case for disc plow, if you remember, okay. We had discussed a very specific point that in places where MV plow cannot be used efficiently because of the hard nature of the ground or because of the dry nature of the soil, we prefer disc plow. The same thing is applicable here. Disc harrows are generally suitable for hard ground, okay, and it obviously cuts the lumps of soil, clods and roots. So this is the basic function that usually any secondary implement would perform. Next, parts of a disc harrow, obviously it would contain disc, right? These are other parts, I'm not going to go into the detail of it, okay. Now let us discuss the types of disc harrows. Okay, so as you can see from the picture, based upon the disc arrangements, okay, this is very important. Okay, so based on the disc arrangements, these disc harrows are divided into two classes. Okay, one is your single action. Okay, the other one is your double action. Okay, you can have a look at the picture. There's other category also, which is called offset. Okay, so all this categorization is depending upon how the discs are arranged. Okay, now for example, in single action, you can see there are two pans. Okay, and in the double action, there are four elements. Okay, so here you can see that the operations, the secondary tillage operations, are going to be performed in four directions. Okay, so based upon this, you need to understand the classification of it. Now let us discuss about single action disc harrow. Okay, so first of all, you can have a look at the picture. So there are two gangs, okay, one and two here. Okay, these are placed at end to end, okay, at an angle which is greater than 90 degrees. So obviously, if it is 90 degrees, it needs to be in perfect L shape, right? But here you can see that it is greater than 90. Plus, both these gangs are arranged in opposite directions. Okay, for example, this right hand side gang would throw the soil in the right side direction, okay, and the left side gang throws it in the left side direction. Okay, so what happens is in both the directions these operations are being performed. Okay, next comes the double action disc harrow. Okay, so again you can have a look at it. 1, 2, 3, and 4, all the four in opposite directions. Okay, so you can see that in all the four directions the operations are taking place. Okay, and the entire field, if you take, because of the kind of arrangement that the gangs are placed in, it is worked twice in each strip. Okay, so this is something very important, just make note of it. Now talking about the double action disc harrow, it can either be of the tandem type or it can be of the offset type. Okay, so when I say tandem type, you can see here that the four gangs, that is 1, 2, 3, and 4, okay, they are angled in opposite directions. Okay, here you can have a look at it in the picture. Okay, and in offset type, what happens is one gang is fitted behind the other. Okay, now this is a gang one, for example. You can see that at the end of this gang, at this point, you have the attachment for the second gang. Okay, so that is how it is placed. Okay, now coming to the types of disc harrows based on the source of power. Okay, so when I talk about it, it can either be tractor drawn or it can be animal drawn. Okay, now based upon this tractor drawn disc harrow, you can see that we have seen two types. Okay, one is single action, double action. Okay, we have already discussed how the gangs are placed and how there are multiple operations happening at the same point of time. We also saw the various classifications of double disc, wherein it can either be offset or it can be in tandem based on the arrangements. Okay, now these are some of the important points which I will not have much to explain in this, but yes, this is important for examination. So what you can just do is maybe pause the video, make a note of these values, because you can get direct questions from this as well, right? And the picture that you are actually seeing on your screens is that of an animal drawn disc harrow. This is also very important, and you need to know that any implement, for that matter, we can classify it based on the source of power. Okay, and whenever you actually come across an implement which is tractor drawn, there's one important term that you should always remember, which is PTO. Okay, power take off shaft. Never forget this. Now this particular tabular column lists down the specifications of tractor drawn disc harrow. Okay, so what you would find in even in your content sheets is that for each of the implement, we have drawn a tabular column wherein you are given important data points regarding it. Now once you're done by understanding what a particular implement does, you can easily comprehend these values. Okay, for example, here the capacity is given, it is 2.5 hectares per day. Now you have understood what a disc harrow does. Okay, so approximately you can keep in mind these values. Then you also have the number of discs. The number of discs, you can see, it can vary from 10 to 16. Okay, so you can see how efficiently one particular implement can work. Okay, then you have the power requirement. Again, this is very important, and here it is referred to the tractor drawn implement, right? Okay, the next type of harrow is a spike tooth harrow. Okay, first have a look at the picture. Try to comprehend how different it is when you compare it with the disc harrows. Okay, so here you can see in the picture as well, there are blade-like structures which are there from the beam, coming out or protruding from the beam. So these are actually used to do the secondary tillage operations, which actually involves the soil inversion as well. Okay, so remember we were discussing that there are two important operations that are usually performed. One is making a cut in the soil. Okay, that is the primary thing that you do. The next one is a soil inversion, wherein you make sure that the bottom layers come to the top. Okay. So here again, as we saw, that it has teeth resembling long spikes, okay, that are obviously used to stir the soil, very important. Okay, now the spike tooth harrow is also known as peck tooth harrow, drag harrow, section or smoothing. Now do not forget, these names are also to be kept in mind, because sometimes what happens is you know the characteristics of a particular implement, but you do not know with which name, other name it is also called. Okay, now the soil, the depth to which it is stirred, this is also very important. Make sure you make note of it. Okay. Now, if you remember that we were discussing an implement which was of rigid type, okay, as well as flexible type. Okay, so I would not take the name again because we have been discussing a lot. But similarly, the same kind of a classification can also be seen in spike tooth harrows. Okay, wherein if the blades, that the long spikes that we just saw in the picture, if they are rigid, we call it as fixed type. Okay, and if they are flexible enough, okay, we call them as flexible type. So it is very simple, just depending upon the characteristics of the spikes that are attached to the long beam. Again, there's a next type of harrow, secondary one, which is called spring tooth harrow. Now you need to comprehend that instead of the long spikes that we had seen in the spike tooth harrow, we have spring-like tooth harrow, spring-like structures protruding. So you can make note of it here. Okay, so let us have a quick look at the characteristics of the spring tooth harrow. So the first important point that you can see here is that it is adopted for use in rough and stony ground. This is an important point. Okay, and the other thing that you need to understand is that when you compare it with the spike tooth harrow, which we were discussing just now, the teeth of the spring tooth harrow will actually penetrate deeper. Okay, so this is important. That's why wherever you find a stony or a hard ground, you would prefer spring tooth harrow rather than the spike one. Okay, now we have other names of given to this spring tooth harrow, which can also be called as quack grass. Okay, it can be called as Bermuda grass eradicator. So keep these points in mind as well. Next, you have the power harrow, which is the tractor drawn. Okay, so again, tractor drawn implement, immediately remember PTO, power takeoff shaft. Okay, and so it actually is obviously used for tilling the soil. Okay, so here nothing much to explain, just understand that the field capacity out here is very important. Make sure you memorize it. Friends, I would just like to point out certain things here. See, what happens is when we are learning these kind of implements, sometimes you just need to be aware of the simple function that it performs, okay, and just have the picture of that particular implement in mind so that you can make a connection. Okay, we are not required here to go deep into the parts or, you know, each and every technicality that is involved. That is not required for us. So whatever the points are required, we are discussing those only. So kindly keep these things in mind. So here I have given a picture of power harrow, which is tractor drawn. You can see here that this is tractor and to it the power harrow is attached. Next comes a rotary tiller. Okay, so again, this is one kind of an implement which is again directly mounted to the tractor and operated. And it actually is known for providing fine degree of soil pulverization. So when I say pulverization, I mean breaking the soil particles into finer particles. Okay, so rotary tiller is basically known for this purpose. Then you have land packer or cultipacker. Okay, again, a important implement. So basically, it consists of a number of cast iron V-shaped rollers. Okay, so this is a different kind of an implement where you have V-shaped rollers attached to the axles. Okay, and sometimes this particular implement can be attached behind disc harrow. Okay, so this is something which you need to know. Now, what are the important points that you need to keep in mind? One is the power requirement. Okay, so kindly make note of this particular important data point. Next, you have rotavator. First, have a look at it in the picture. Okay, so you can see how there are blades which are curved, are protruding out. Okay, these would actually go deep into the soil. So basically, it consists of a steel frame. Okay, there's a three-point hitch system, a rotary shaft on which the blades are mounted. You can see there was a shaft like this. Okay, and you saw that there were blades protruding out of it. So that is what they are referring to here. Okay, and the blades are of L shape. We can see that as well. Okay, so again, very important. Now, why this particular implement is very important for us is because it is used for both primary and secondary tillage operations. So kindly make note of this point. Okay, so again, it is tractor drawn, so it uses power from the tractor PTO, that is power takeoff shaft. Okay, and this particular implement can be used in both dry land as well as wet land conditions. Very important. Okay. Next, again, just quickly showing you the picture. So what we were discussing, so there's a rotary shaft you can see here on which the blades are mounted, and these blades, you can see these are L-shaped blades, okay, used for both primary and secondary operations, used for both dry land as well as wet land conditions. So you can see how important this particular implement is. Now let us have a look at the specification of it. So the working depth, if you see, it is nearly 80 to 100 mm. Important, kindly make note of it. Okay, you have the capacity, that is 0.38 to 0.50 hectare per hour. Then you have the power source which is there, okay, which is nothing but 35 to 65 HP tractor. Okay, so it is tractor mounted. So kindly keep these values in mind. Now talking about specifically the tillage implements used for rice cultivation. Okay, so one is the cage wheels. You can have a look at it here in the picture. So very evident it is, the huge wheels that are there. These are basically iron wheels. Okay, and why iron wheels? Because, you know, in the plowing of rice fields, which is filled with water, if you start using rubber wheels, it is going to cause slippage. Okay, to overcome this particular difficulty in cage wheels, the iron wheels are used. Okay. Next, there is important implement which is called puddler. Okay, and you can have a look at it here as well in the picture, and it is basically used for churning the soil in standing water. Okay, so obviously for rice cultivation it is used. The puddling is done in standing water, which is of depth 5 to 10 centimeter. This is important. You can even get a direct question on the depth of it. Okay, so basically, you know what, if you talk about rice cultivation, the main thing here is there's always water filled in the field. Okay, so because of that, you need to accordingly choose your implement, because the other kind of implements would not work well where in the standing water. Okay. So friends, with this, we have come to the end of this particular lecture. So till now, we have actually discussed a lot when it comes to agricultural engineering. So I just want to put a word out here that do not get scared of this particular chapter. It is fairly simple, provided you understand what is the requirement from the point of view of examination. And that is exactly what we have covered in these lectures so far. So after this, we will just move on and discuss some of the other implements in general. Okay, so far we are done with the tractor part, which is again very important. We are done with the farm mechanization, wherein each of the stages we use various implements, from land leveling to sowing to seedbed preparation to maybe weeding and interculture operation to harvesting. We saw in each of these processes what are the kinds of implements that you can use. So always keep in mind that a particular implement, what is the purpose of it, okay, and what are the important characteristics of it. That is very important for us. Okay, and that is exactly what we have discussed. We dedicated a separate chapter for tillage implements, wherein we divided it into primary and secondary. We saw them one by one, right? So with this, this part ends here, and I hope you found this video useful. Thank you so much and happy learning.